Okay. Thank you, Jacob. Let me say, as always, it's a great pleasure to be here. And for many reasons, I have some of them I'll actually mention in the talk. I have a lot of fond mathematical and personal memories of my time spent in Brazil over various decades now. And I made this title, Rigorous Results, because I was afraid of saying what the real title was, and that is some rigorous and some non-rigorous, and how you approach what we do know and can prove, and how you approach the proofs of other things. But before, I just want to make sure this, unfortunately, I don't know how to keep it lit all the time. I guess there's a way to turn the screensaver on, and if I took the time to do that, I would use 30 minutes, so I don't want, it's a new computer, but I'll just keep trying to pay attention. Let me mention, so I was thinking, stimulated very much by some of the things I heard earlier this week. So this is a prelude, which is a little prelude in a musical concert, sometimes has nothing to do with the main program, and that's what this prelude is. I saw mentioning things about complex analytic situations and about C1 situations, and we will hear more. So this morning at breakfast, I had a conversation with Ms. Lyubich about these related things, and he mentioned, so first of all, we have C1. Then, of course, you have CR with some things in between, and then you have analytic. And he mentioned that, in his opinion, perhaps the difference between C1 and CR, this difference, let's call it the difference here, difference one, was much bigger than this difference. The difference between CR and analytic. That is, the CR phenomena should mirror the analytic phenomena in some sense more closely in various things. Well, as I was riding in, it occurred to me that, you know, Misha's a very smart guy, and there are many, many things here between CR and C omega, and maybe too many to think about. So I, instead of having this infinite number, I would prefer one gap and look at C infinity to C omega, and that gives me the right to mention a conjecture in C infinity. As you know, if I have, and let's start just with a surface diffeomorphism of a compact surface, M2. As you know, if you have the positive topological entropy, then you always have measures of maximal entropy. There exist maximal measures. And the question is, how many? And in particular, typically you may have an infinite number, but if you require that they be ergodic, it's not clear. In the hyperbolic situation, the axiom A situation, it's a well-known theorem established by Rufus Bowen decades ago, that it's what's called finitely ergodic. It has only if you have positive entropy, you have a finite number of measures of maximal entropy for a hyperbolic thing. And the conjecture is the same thing is true here. For a C infinity surface diffeomorphism with positive entropy, this is the set of ergodic maximal measures. The cardinality of this should be finite. And in fact, more on each homoclinic class, which we know exists because of Cattalk theorem, in each homoclinic class, you should have a unique maximal ergodic measure, and it's measured theoretically Bernoulli. So that's the conjecture, that's the prelude. I haven't thought about this problem for a long time, but for a number of years before I did, and now we have much more technology, so I mentioned that as a problem, that if the new title I give to this lecture is not interesting, you can start thinking about this and maybe have something to say about it. Okay, in any event, now to my real talk. In the last few years, I've been interested in the Lorenz differential equations, Here is the Lorenz differential equations. It's a three-parameter family of differential equations in R3. The parameters I'm going to denote by sigma, rho, and beta. And this exhibits a huge amount of interesting dynamical properties. And so let's start talking about a few of them. First of all, why study the Lorenz system? There's reason to believe that most of the phenomena that you see in bifurcation theory, dynamics, and so on in three-dimensional vector fields, and maybe two-dimensional surfaces, and maybe one-dimensional dynamics, can be exhibited in this simple system, quadratic system of differential equations, for some parameters. And that's a meta statement. It's not completely true, and there are some interesting conjectures about it that I'll talk about as we go on. But so one reason it's very rich dynamics that may give you information about many kinds of three-dimensional differential equations, not just this particular family. That's the first thing. The second one is it describes certain well-known physical systems. And I don't mean the fluid systems that this was derived from. In fact, it probably doesn't describe those. But there are systems involving lasers, spikes in lasers. There's a water wheel example of a wheel that was invented by Malchus, a wheel with cups and so on. And you have something that you spin the wheel and you have cups and you have water going into the cups and down at the bottom some of them go out. And you can write down the equations that model this. So it describes certain physical systems. That's actually not my main motivation. It's in the popular mathematical culture. If you really understand and describe this, some people are going to pay attention. It's not going to take decades to find out. But the most important reason is that, and this will be germane to the main subject of my talk, is that there has been, in the early 80s, a detailed, careful, numerical investigation of what is likely to occur in this system for many parameters. And most of this is numerical, almost none of it. The number of things that are proved about these things that Colin Sparrow described in his famous book, the number of things that have actually been proved is very minimal. I'm going to contribute a little bit of that today to that aspect today with various kinds of techniques. But mainly, there are many, many conjectures. For example, and we'll talk about this, are there structurally stable Lorentz systems with infinite non-wandering set? Not proved. I'll give you hints about why that might be true, and we're close to proving something like that later on in the talk. But that kind of question. So the original mathematical description, which I'll talk about a little later, had to do with a certain small set of parameters. If you let the parameters vary a lot, there are many different kinds of phenomena that appear, and almost none of it is proved yet. So many problems to study. And of course, the standard parameters that everybody knows that draws the Lorentz butterfly and so on, I'll refer to those as the standard parameters, are the ones that were originally presented in Lorentz's paper in 1963, rho equals 28, beta equals 8/3, and sigma equals 10. Okay, so we will assume now that all the parameters are positive. That's sort of natural to do, and in any event, there's already enough to do there. Okay? And let's establish some of the basic properties of the Lorentz system. First of all, it's invariant under this form of the equations under the symmetry which reflects in the z-axis. There's the symmetry. You just reflect the xy coordinates, keep the z-coordinate the same. If the parameter for any sigma and beta, if the parameter is between 0 and 1, then it's a trivial system. The origin is globally asymptotically stable. There's a simple Lyapunov function that tells you the motion. So to become somewhat interesting, you should let rho be bigger than 1. In this case, in the rho less than 1, there's a single critical point. Here, you branch into three critical points, which are easy to find. If you let alpha be this number, square root of beta times rho minus 1, your critical points are at alpha, rho minus 1, the reflected image minus alpha, rho minus 1, and the origin. You have three critical points. Okay. There is a change. Now, we want to study what happens when certain parameters change. These critical points, if the parameters like rho and beta change, they change. It would be nice to stabilize them as you move the parameter. So we'll call the normalized Lorentz system the one obtained by rescaling in this special way. Whoops, this is a new, you know, the problem is this has many buttons. Yeah. The normalized system, let me put that down. The normalized system will be the one where you shift the non-zero critical points to unit places, to the 1, 1, 1, and minus 1, minus 1, 1. And the equation still is very simple. It's still quadratic, and it looks like this. Here's what the new equation is. Instead of a rho minus z, it becomes a rho minus 1z, and instead of xy minus beta z, it becomes a beta times xy minus z. This already gives you some indication of something that's easy to do as you change parameters. Notice that the z-coordinate is always going down if you are below, if z is less than the paraboloid, z equals xy, right? The z coordinate, z dot is negative. And if you're above the parabola, you're going down. If you're below the parabola, you're going up, okay? So you get an easy kind of thing that is potentially useful in ways that we will see later. So let me do some of the history. The earliest work, of course, the presentation was by Ed Lorenz, who was an atmospheric scientist working at MIT. He wrote a paper that we didn't know about and didn't notice for many years because Smale would not have made certain conjectures had he known about this paper in the late 60s, a paper called Deterministic Non-Periodic Flow. So that paper was sitting somewhere and people did not know it existed. It was discovered and made popular among pretty much most of the geometric dynamics community, including the West and the East, even the Russians. I talked to Sinai about this. They became aware of this basically through the proselytizing of Jim York. And so I talked to Jim about this a couple of weeks ago and asked him, where did he hear about it? And it turned out it's one of those accidental things. He was at the Institute for Fluid Dynamics, as it was called, now it's Physical Science and Technology at the University of Maryland, and doing his kinds of things, and there was a fluid physicist, fluid dynamics, named Al Fowler, who had gotten his PhD at MIT, and he came there, and when they were discussing things, he gave a bunch of copies of Lorenz's paper to Jim to look at. And so Jim started looking at these papers and trying to understand and saw some geometry and was heavy into basic numerical computations on minimal kinds of computers at the time. And so he became aware of this interesting dynamical system. Somewhat later at a meeting, he encountered... I think it was, I can find out, of course, but that, I mean, you know, it went over a period of time because initially he didn't read the papers, Fowler, and they would meet at tea. Did you look at them yet? That kind of thing. I think it was early 70s, 72 or 3, because the first published paper, and Jim was not shy about publishing things, right, early on when he did numerical things. The Kaplan-York paper was in 79 was that, but Guggenheimer, let me tell you about Guggenheimer, because I also asked him about the history. Well, first, Steve mentioned this to Smale, and hence gave a copy of Lorenz's paper to Smale, and Smale at a meeting. Later on, Smale spread this paper around when he went back to Berkeley to a number of people, including Rufus Bowen. And Guggenheimer happened to be there, and so Guggenheimer got a copy of Lorenz's paper from Bowen and then started looking at it and realizing it. And of course, Guggenheimer was aware of density, non-density, axiom A, hyperbolic issues. And studying the numerics in this paper, he came up with the geometric model, what we more or less call the geometric model for the Lorentz equations, for the parameters, standard parameters. And he wrote a paper that appears in the book of Marsden and McCracken on the Hough bifurcation that's called a strange attractor. Strange attractor, we all knew about. This was even more strange. And the reason is it was topologically omega stable, and not omega stable in a system that didn't look like it changed terribly much in some ways, and it had persistently non-hyperbolicity because it had a critical point in the non-wandering set for a whole open set. So it was a new phenomena in dynamical systems. Later on, in fact, I was here in IMPA when Bob Williams became aware of Guggenheimer's paper and work, preprint or something, and started thinking about how you would describe this using branched manifolds, of course, because that was Bob Williams. And that was down here. I remember him discussing it. And Bob's not here now, but I'll make a comment. He said to me personally, I said, oh, you understand this? He said, well, I don't completely understand it yet, but I can say I understand it better than Guggenheimer did. So, so he said, and in fact, it was true for many reasons if you study what ultimately happened. So they got together, and they got together and wrote, there's a paper in the IHES publication in 1979 by Guggenheimer and Williams describing the structure of the Lorenz system near these parameters. And basically, they're not structurally stable, but they depend only on, for the Lorenz system, one real parameter because of the symmetry. If you remove the symmetry, it's two real parameters. So it's not so terrible, not so complicated for the geometric model. That's what they wrote together. In the same issue, Williams has a paper describing his understanding in terms of branched manifolds, or what he calls templates, and then he went on further to study topological problems connected with the templates together with knots and other kinds of things with Joan Berman. One of the consequences of their work is that all the periodic orbits that appear are knotted, and you have infinitely many different knot types in these things. So it became interesting to the topologist as a consequence of this. Okay, somewhat later, much later, this was 79, by 2001, Warwick Tucker gave a computer-assisted proof of the geometric model for the classical parameters and for small perturbations. I'll talk more about that a little bit later. Some comments about that. But I want to, as I was thinking, as I've become aware of Lorenz, I started reading more and more Sparrow's book, and there is just a whole bunch of stuff in there to really understand and study, and there's some interesting mathematical papers that this, my community that I knew, just didn't even talk about, that I found out. I'm going to tell you some of them. In 1979, Kay Robbins wrote a paper where she proved that for beta equals 1 and sigma equals 5 and very, very large rho, there's a unique stable periodic orbit. This is discussed in Sparrow's book, okay? And then Sparrow extended this with numerical investigations to looking at this relationship between sigma and beta and letting rho run for large rho. So take this relation zeta, and in the back of his book, or in the various chapters, you will see the following kind of statement, that if zeta is less than 2/3 and r is arbitrarily large, there are no periodic orbits. Actually, I never studied that, so I don't know what phenomena appear there, whether there's chaos or not. Between 2/3 and 1 in this relation of sigma and beta, there is one stable, asymptotically stable periodic orbit and two unstable ones. It could be a more Smale system. You have the critical points. You have these periodic orbits. It could be more Smale. We don't know. Okay, and I never thought about it hard. And when zeta is bigger than 1, you have a unique stable periodic orbit for very, very large r. Okay, and so this led, in fact, in the studies, Sparrow made a conjecture in his book that is, notice that the last parameter, zeta bigger than 1, is what happens when you take the standard sigma and beta, because sigma is 10, that's 11 over 8/3 plus 2, that's 12/3, or no, okay, anyhow, it's true. This is bigger than 1 for those parameters. And so for large rho, you seem to have a unique stable periodic orbit. Actually, there's a sketch of a proof of that using averaging method and results of Swinnert and Dyer in Sparrow's book, but when I found out about this result and looked at Robin's paper, this is a much more general kind of statement, not just beta equals 1, but a whole bunch of parameters. I asked him where the paper was, and they never wrote it. So there is a technique which Swinnerton Dyer more or less thought he could use to prove. There's an outline in Sparrow's book in one of the appendices, but there's no detailed proof of that. So we don't know that yet completely. That's just the state. By the way, Robbins, K. Robbins, did prove the stability of the periodic orbit. She didn't study any other kinds of dynamical properties. So the natural conjecture is that for large rho in this range, the system is a Morse-Mayle system with a unique stable periodic orbit. Again, we don't know a proof of that. What we do have is for certain rows with the standard parameters, if sigma is 10 and beta equals 8/3, there is a proof, it is computer assisted, of the fact that for rho equals 350, you actually have a stable periodic solution. So let me show you, okay. Yeah. Let me show you what happened. Get rid of that. When you use a new computer, the technology's a little bit weird. Okay, yes. Okay, let me show you numerically what this looks like. Here is your stable periodic orbit. Now remember, I normalized the coordinates, so this would be really large r. It'll be way out there with beta times r minus 1. But when you bring it back to the normal coordinates, it looks like this. Okay? And here is a three-dimensional picture. This horizontal is x. This is y, and z is the height, of course. If you pull it down and reflect, and take where x is horizontal going toward your right and y is vertical, it's a very beautiful periodic orbit. And what happens now, let's ask, and I don't have the numerical pictures, but what happens when rho gets bigger even? Well, it flattens out. It sort of flattens out to a symmetric periodic orbit, which looks like this picture. Here is this box. And it looks something like a very beautiful thing like this, where these actually should be at the tops and bottoms. I'm not going to take the time to redraw it now. But it becomes something very familiar to people who teach low-dimensional differential equations. If you draw the Duffing equation, you know that, and you make it into a system, you have a homoclinic orbit like this. You have a center like this. And then you have a bunch of symmetric periodic orbits that go around like that forever, and you describe everything with the two-dimensional Duffing equation. So I looked at this and I said, and when you get large, this looks like one of the periodic orbits in the Duffing equation. How did that appear? Duffing equation is a conservative system, right? The Lorenz is completely dissipated when you go to large r, and the answer is, this was actually proved by Robbins in her paper. When you go back and look, there is a change of coordinates, a time-dependent scale change. And unfortunately, I didn't bring that out with me. Let me do that to show you this beautiful picture and show you some of the analysis that one can get in these things. Yeah. There is a change of coordinates of the following form. You let the time, it's time dependent, be epsilon tau. You let x1 be epsilon x. You let y1 be epsilon squared sigma y. You let w1, for a reason I'll tell you in a minute, be the same epsilon squared sigma w. W replaces the z coordinate. It's r minus z, like that. And then what you get with this change of coordinates, and you let prime equal dd tau, what you get is the following system, x1 prime equals y1. This is the actual, I'll tell you what epsilon is in a minute. Y1 prime equals x1 w1 minus epsilon y1, and w1 prime, r minus z, is minus x1 y1 plus epsilon times 1 minus beta w1. Now, Robbins did this for beta equals 1, but it's the same kind of construction. And so when epsilon is 0, what happens? You get this system. I don't recognize that system. Amazingly, that's a completely integrable system in the plane. It has, in three dimensions, it's a completely integrable system. You have the following integrals. You have w1 squared plus y1 squared is a constant. This quadratic surface, parabolic cylinder, and you have, this cylinder, and then you have the paraboloid. This equals c. So if you draw the picture in three space, these are constants of motion when epsilon is 0. So then I didn't tell you what epsilon was. It's 1 over the square root of r beta sigma. So for fixed beta a sigma, if you let r get big, epsilon gets small. And so what you get here is a picture like this. Here is w1. So it's a translated z. Here is x1, here is y1. You have this parabolic cylinder, which is given by the first equation, and then you have a paraboloid, which is you take a parabola, and this depends on your d and c, right? Your d is some positive, what happens to c? It goes up and down, the paraboloid, right, like that. And you slide this back, and when it hits, you get, these are both constants of motion, so the intersection of these surfaces are the orbits. So this is an integrable system at r equals infinity, right, epsilon equals 0, right, in the Lorentz system derived, and then you just have to perturb away from this and let epsilon be positive, and that's exactly what Robbins does for beta equals 1 and produces this large stable periodic orbit. But you get a beautiful geometric picture of what it's going to look like in rescaled coordinates. So you discover a whole bunch of things. Anyhow, I won't talk more about that, that appear in various cases in this situation. Okay. Let me go back now to the topic. So what I wanted to show you, this periodic orbit I just discussed was actually proved in a rigorous way by Wittig and Zhou. Yuting Zhou, I'll mention her a little bit later, is a graduate student in mathematics at Michigan State. Alex Wittig recently got a joint PhD in math and physics at Michigan State as well. And they, once numerically you could find out that such a thing should exist, you have computer-assisted techniques to try to actually prove it, and they did it. They succeeded for this value like that. Okay, so let's move on. That's the first kind of phenomena, large R. By the way, more smell, nobody knows. We really aren't close to that yet. Okay, let's go on. Now let's ask the question, what about zero homoclinic points? That is, in certain parameters I'll describe in right now, when rho is sufficiently large, and now I'm going to pretty much take, I'll tell you what relations there are between sigma and beta in a minute. You can ask the question of when, let me work with this side, because I'm right-handed, and maybe it won't get interfered with. So you can ask the question of what happens at the origin. And for rho bigger than 1 at a certain size, and certain parameters, sigma and beta, I will tell you in a minute, you might have a two-dimensional stable manifold, a one-dimensional unstable manifold, and you might have the chance to have what's called typically a homoclinic butterfly. It comes back, so it's symmetric. So once you see this coming back here, the other is just a reflected image with the xy going to minus x minus y. You might have that behavior. Well, Hastings and Troy proved that not for the standard parameters, but for sigma equals 10, beta nearly 1, and rho equals 1,000. with a computer-assisted proof, okay? Then there was a series, that was 1994. So this is later than Sparrow's book. Sparrow actually gave indications of where this might exist, and I'll tell you a little about that in a few minutes. But Hastings and Troy actually did this for in 1994. It's a nice paper, it's computer assisted. And then there was a series of papers by Xinfu Chen, which I discovered a little bit later looking on the internet, and he proved these really very beautiful theorems. When sigma and beta are positive and rho is less than one, plus less than one, it's asymptotically stable, not interesting. But bigger than one and less than this number, beta over two sigma, there are no null homoclinic points. He proves that with Lyapunov function techniques. And so if you go in this region, no homoclinic points, if you take your rho bigger, then you have necessary and sufficient conditions for some rho bigger than that to have a null homoclinic point. It happens if and only if you have these parameters of sigma and beta, sigma bigger than 1 plus 2 beta over 3. And then he wrote a beautiful paper which wasn't published. It's still available in the IMA preprint series, thank heavens, because I got it. For every beta greater than 0, there is a sigma and a large rho such that the system has hyperbolicity. He actually proves hyperbolicity. He proves the existence of a shift in there, and it is a substantial piece of work, of analysis and so on. A few little misprints because it wasn't published. Now, you might say, why wasn't it published? And the answer is, I actually sent him a message because I was, the way I found the paper is I saw the first two and was looking for this, and it said to appear, it wasn't there. He said it ultimately, he sent it to a top journal. He was very pleased with the paper. He was a postdoc at the IMA in Minnesota. And it was rejected, so he lost interest. He said, no, people don't really care. And so he never tried to publish the paper. But it is a beautiful paper. Interesting analysis and so on. Again, a change of coordinates related to the Robbins change. By the way, this change of coordinates, let's get the history. Here's some other interesting thing. This rescaling was not suggested by Robbins. It was suggested by Lou Howard, who I've been trying to find out. He gave some lectures on fluid dynamics at Woods Hole in the early 70s, 72 or so. Kay Robbins was there as a student or a postdoc, I don't know exactly, maybe. And she saw this scaling, and then she decided to play with it a little bit. And actually, it may be that Howard had another proof of the existence of the periodic orbit, but not the stability. She was able to do an asymptotic analysis. And it basically comes down to an interesting kind of business with the implicit function theorem and the special functions. As we all know, if you take a Duffing equation, like this, Duffing's equation is x dot in the plane, y dot equals x minus x cubed over 3, plus or minus this. I always have to get, on this side it's a plus, so that's right. Like that. This actually has explicit solutions in terms of elliptic functions, Jacobi elliptic functions. And she uses, there's things, analogs of sines, cosine, all this classical analysis appears here in the Lorenz equation as you go asymptotically. So she actually uses those functions explicitly, various information that she obviously was classically trained about those to prove the existence of this periodic. So there's a lot of analysis that comes into this stuff. It's very beautiful. Okay, so let's go back to this business. In the proof that of hyperbolicity that Chen employs, he does not use the exact same change of coordinates. There's a slightly different one. So you still have something that is integrable in the first two coordinates, one constant of motion, the same one for here. But in this one, it comes back in another way. And he studies the homoclinic orbit there and the bifurcation associated to it. Now, how large you have to be for this and various things, we don't know. So that leads me to the next question. First of all, the remark, all of these results require very large rho and give small positive topological entropy. So the question is, can you get modest topological entropy? Well, the answer is, in the classical parameters, of course you can get them, because the entropy isn't so small there. But if you, once you have Tucker's justification, but let me go back before that, to what led Jim York to actually make this paper available, and that's why I was guessing around 72 or 3 or something, maybe a little later, is York and Kaplan wrote a paper in the CMP in 1979 called Pre-Turbulence of Regime Observed in a Fluid Flow of Lorentz. And again, I think this was mainly motivated by their numerical, Jim's numerical, Kaplan was a colleague of his, numerical explorations based on the papers of Lorentz directly. And he studied, the parameters were sigma. So remember Lorentz, rho was 28, sigma was 10, beta is equal 8/3. So you change rho. And he changed it to these parameters, around 13.26, and numerically studied this. At this range, the two unit critical points that I talked about are attracting. They're not saddle type yet. And they made the conjecture based on their numerical studies that near this value of rho, you have a pair of null homoclinic loops created. And you might study what happens afterwards. This particular parameter is exactly, was studied later by Hazard and Zhang with a computer, I'm sorry, the proof of the homoclinic point for Hastings and Troy was not computer assisted, it was an analytic proof. This is the first appearance of a computer assisted proof in Lorentz, and Hazard and Zhang, and what they did, well, let me first show you some pictures of the likely, of the pictures that Jim York actually found. I did these myself with computer techniques, but you will see, and it becomes very nice. Let's move that over there and try to find the other one. Yeah. Let's get rid of that one. Well, get rid of that one. I'm sorry. Yeah, there's one. And that must be the other one. There it is. That's one. Oh, I thought I got rid of, I had two of those open. Give me a break for a minute. There we go. Okay, yeah, I knew I could get there. In this picture, you see a three-dimensional version. You have the unstable manifold. Here's the critical point at the origin. You have the unstable manifold dying. The other critical point is at 1, 1, 1, and minus, or minus 1. So somewhere over here, if I pull this down so you see the XY coordinates, in other words, look down from the top, you see the number 1, 1, which is right there. That's one critical point. On z equals 1, x and y equal 1. The other one is the symmetric image on minus 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, which is here. And if you go up, you see that the unstable manifold to the right of the critical point, by the way, in this range, you do have a two-dimensional stable and one-dimensional unstable. Critical point at the origin is not attracting anymore. The unstable manifold dies at this critical point, and the symmetric image dies at this critical point. This is for rho equals 13.9265. If you make rho a little bit bigger to 9266, what you see is this picture. And here, what has happened is, by the way, this green is part of the stable manifold of the origin in the z equals 1 plane. So what you see here is this unstable loop comes back very close on the right to the green. You see right there how close it is? I would make it bigger, but I'm afraid to touch this computer more. Here, you see it looks more or less the same on the right, but it has come to the other side. It has gone from one side of the green to the other side. It has crossed the stable manifold, and now its orbit dies at this critical point. So you go from one critical point dying for both, and then you have the symmetric image, which I did not draw because it would make it look more complicated. So you go across. You have the picture, and you have the picture that here is the stable manifold. Sitting something like that. Actually, it's horizontal in the picture that I have there. It goes down. You have this unstable coming up to this side and then dying at a critical point over here. And as you increase the parameter, it goes across. Okay, that's what York studied. And so the question is, can you prove the existence of chaos there? And we are close to doing that with a computer-assisted proof. We have not really gotten there yet. And I'll explain what's needed, and you'll believe that it's true. So let's go back here. In addition, before I tell you about that, I want to mention that Kaplan and York actually did further investigation. And after this critical point is, this homoclinic loop is created, they saw numerical evidence of a shift in there that is hyperbolic dynamics. This is for low rho. This is for rho around 13, not huge rho. Huge rho, Chen proved it. Low rho, we don't know. They showed the existence of a K, of something like a shift in there that happens. And so the natural conjecture is that near this value of parameters, you have a hyperbolic set, which is like a suspension of a two-shift. On one side, you have more Smail, where the unstable curves of the origin go to the two attracting critical points. At the boundary, you have something. And then slightly to the other side, you have a hyperbolic system. And that's what York at the time, that's what York actually did. Just a minute, Zay. That's what he actually observed. And then he's made the comment, and it also seems that almost all the orbits, even with the hyperbolicity, almost all tend to one of the attracting critical points. Okay? In our modern language, that would say that right on the other side, this is a what's called, nowadays might be called a Smail flow. It's a hyperbolic flow in three dimensions whose non-wandering set is one-dimensional, the analog of a Smail diffeomorphism with a two-shift as a hyperbolic set, infinite hyperbolic set, not more Smail, where the non-wandering set is zero-dimensional. Here it's like a suspension of that, more or less. That's still not proved, but we have a good idea that we're close to that, and let me explain why, and this also brings back IMPA a little bit. Yes, now. Between 13, I can tell you later, between 13.9265 and 9266. Actually, I did further experiments. It's even much closer than that. But that's what, yes, yes, much before that. So the progress toward this is what's called a partial linearization. This is something that I did with Yuting Zhou for her thesis. And I want to tell you about it because the motivation for this, after thinking for a while, turns out to be things I learned here at IMPA many, many years ago, and you will understand very well why. Okay, so what is a partial linearization? I'm gonna actually, yeah, here is the, let's go and do it here. The prelude is over, we don't need it. So we have a three-dimensional diffeomorphism now with a separated set of eigenvalues, looks like this. Let's call this one A, this one B, and this one C. And here I want A to be bigger than 1 in absolute value. Let's make it positive just so we keep things simple. I want B to be less than 1, and then I want C to be stronger, like this, okay? And what is the problem in our situation? And so this is a diffeomorphism. It's a C2 diffeomorphism of R3 with separated eigenvalues. Now, the way people study this problem always is assume the thing is linearizable near the origin and then make some analysis. In the case of the actual standard Lorenz, it is linearizable. It is actually linearizable there. You can do the non-resonance conditions of the Sternberg theorem and verify that. That's another subject. I won't go there right now. But in this case, as you move from 13.9265 to 13.9266, many, many places occur where you have resonance. Okay, so it is not linearizable. So what do you do? Can you do anything? And the answer is there's a relatively simple solution. And that brings up what I call a partial linearization. Let's assume this is the stable manifold. We can flatten that out. And this is the unstable, and it's flattened out. And we know in the stable manifold, the orbits go like that. I'm going to do this picture for vector fields, but it's true for diffeos and vector fields by standard techniques. So this orbit actually discretely goes down, but the vector field would go like that. So draw a curve, a C2 curve gamma, which is transverse to the stable manifold off the strong stable, okay? What happens to such a curve? Well, the foot goes down here, and if you do this as a vector field, the top will go to something that looks like that, right? If it were linear, that's what it would look like, if it were linear near the origin, right? It's an easy estimate, but it's not. So what do? Well, this curve going down generates a surface. What kind of a surface is it? Well, it's a C1 plus alpha surface in this generality. In this Lorenz, you actually have that, by the way, the C is exponential of the stable eigenvalue, right? This is the time 1 map or time t map. So to save time, I'm just going to work with the vector field case. So let's do vector fields. Then you have A positive bigger than B and bigger. In fact, in the Lorenz situation, you have this. I can tell you what the eigenvalues are. It's an EG algebraic calculation. So this is strong enough in hyperbolicity to make this a candidate for a C2 surface, invariant surface for the vector field. If you have a C2 surface for a vector field, the vector field is C1 linearizable. So we can actually do linear estimates in the surface, right? And however, well, if we knew that we had such a surface which was C2 and invariant like that, you could do linearizability in here. Well, okay, in Yuting's thesis, in Zhou's thesis, we were mainly interested in Lorenz, so we did this condition here. Somewhat later, I started thinking a little bit harder about that and realized that why the two? Because that means that this surface is 2 normally hyperbolic and hence C2 if your original thing was at least C2. Well, in Lorenz, it's analytic, no problem. So this is a C2 surface. If the C is just bigger, if this isn't there, then it's a C1 plus alpha surface, where alpha is some Hölder condition. So you have a C2 surface and a diffeomorphism on it, which is C1 plus alpha. Is it linearizable? Is the Hartmann theorem about C1 linearizability of C2 things valid for C1 plus alpha? The answer is yes. And it's more or less the same proof. How do you prove this is linearizable? You first linearize here. Well, Sternberg on these curves, Sternberg does this for C2, C1 linearizability. You look at the proof as a graduate student and you don't know much, and so you do this, you see that it's C1 plus alpha, it still works. It's a C1 linearization in a C1 plus alpha thing. This curve up here, you iterate forward on there and you get yourself some kind of surface. The surface, unfortunately, is only C1 plus alpha, so you need the C1 plus alpha thing. The point is that in this situation, the vector field X or the diffeomorphism restricted to S is C1 linearizable. Now, how do I prove that? And actually, since the time is short, I have maybe 2 minutes or something, let me go here and describe how I do it, because it has connections with IMPA again. Just to prove that there are C1, let's suppose the eigenvalue conditions give you 2 normal hyperbolicity. Just to prove that you had a C1 manifold, a C2 manifold under 2 normal hyperbolicity is easy. You use standard globalization techniques that you do when you do center manifolds. Okay, it's the same argument. So there are many such smooth invariant surfaces. That's not good enough for what we need. We need the surfaces to go through every curve, because we want to take vectors in this direction, do the return to here, and see that we have some kind of expansion with the usual quotient of eigenvalues that Marco Martens talked about yesterday, that kind of thing. So it's not enough. So we thought for longer than I would like to say, because I'm now getting older, about how to do this for arbitrary curves. But if I had been here and been able to have a little tea with Jacob, I would have known how to do it with arbitrary curves. Because in his thesis, he did tubular families, invariant foliations near the geometric proof of Hartmann's theorem. And so the answer is, you take this curve and you look at its first image, and then you fill it in any way you want with a nice family of curves, and you iterate forward and you keep going down, and you get yourself a candidate for You first of all do Sternberg in this direction linear. You do Sternberg in this direction linear. Then you put them together with this as a surface, and you have a C1 plus alpha surface with C1 invariant curves, and you use these coordinates as horizontal coordinates, and you use vertical coordinates, and you get yourself a linearization. It turns out this is actually a C1 linearization, even if the diffeomorphism or the vector field is only C1 plus alpha. And I checked that with CatTalk because I was a little nervous about it. I said, that should be around, right? And he wrote back, he said, yes, it's true. It follows from this in my book. And I looked in the book and it didn't follow from that in the book at all. So at least he believed that it was true and didn't have an arbitrary counterexample to begin with. That made me actually continue with the proof, okay? In Yu Ting's thesis, in her thesis, she does the vector field case, and she does the vector field case for C1. There, I mean, where the invariant manifold is C2, and that's sort of more or less standard techniques. The C1 plus alpha we still have to write and do, but it's true. What does this do for you? Every invariant curve allows you to estimate the growth from of this derivative to that derivative. And if the eigenvalue conditions for the diffeo satisfy that B plus A is less than 1, the derivative turns out to be, if you think of this as a coordinate, this direction x, and this height, the derivative turns out to be 1 minus B over A. The map is like x to the alpha. That's what Marco talked about yesterday. The derivative is x to the alpha derivative. It's right. You have alpha minus 1 in this, and you do it right. So this turns out to be very, very big. This kind of linearization is uniform in the curves. So if you just have the bounded angle, so the actual statement here, which I guess I'll have to finish with in my lecture, and then tell you a statement, which, where's the picture? Where is it? Does it die after a while and not give you anything? Okay, the actual statement is that you have the linearization that allows you to pretend you had linearization in a neighborhood, okay? And the linearization depends on the angle and the C2 size of this curve, so it's uniform. That gives you exactly what all the linearization estimates in the C2, in the critical point that are done give you. It gives you all of that. One final, since I know the time is gone, one final comment about here. By the way, the theorem I was going to talk about is the fact that for large parameters, we actually have hyperbolicity. I mean, we actually have positive entropy and all those kinds of issues. And that's computer-assisted. This is not. So maybe since I'm stuck in this world and I'm doing rigorous non-computer things, I'll stay here. Okay. What does this allow you to do? One final comment, and then I'll end. If you look at Tucker's thing, Tucker has two parts. This is the standard Tucker picture, or Guggenheimer-Williams picture. You go, and we saw the picture yesterday, like that. And here we go, and here we go, and here we go, like this. You actually have smooth linearizability in a neighborhood of the origin for the standard parameters, for rho, beta sigma equals 28, 8/3, 10. If you change this a little bit, you do not. For example, if you look at 28.6 and 9, 28.6, 3, and 10. What happens in that situation? If you do the computer, it looks more or less the same. But the eigenvalues at the origin here are minus 23, 12, and minus 3, beta's minus 3, okay? These have a resonance of order 6. So Tucker's proof has two parts, a part using linearization in a certain neighborhood here, and then a part that's computer-assisted outside. Outside, you still have to do some kind of computation, but inside, his proof fails for these values completely. He uses non-resonance conditions of order 20. So how are you going to do estimates there? You use the partial linearization and get the same estimates, okay? And you need to know the size of the neighborhood, so we're working on that. So we're optimistic that we have, number one, a better computer-assisted proof outside so that you can actually do it in finite time. That hasn't been done yet. And near the critical point, we use the partial linearization to obviate, to remove Tucker's necessity. And so there's lots of things to do in terms of this, and we're very optimistic we'll make some progress. Thank you.